So hello everybody. So I'm Jordan Keval and I've been a PhD student for 6 months now at PSA Automobile and IRDL de Lorient. And this presentation concerns the numerical study of the weldability of a dissymmetric assembly during resistance spot welding. This study has been achieved in partnership with Transvalor and ArcelorMittal during my Master 2 internship. So first of all, some precisions about the outline and aims of this work. So in automotive industry, to improve the structural performance and achieve lightweighting goals, new families of high-strength steel and very thin sheet are introduced in the design in body in white. We can find on the body in white dissymmetric assemblies, including sheets of different steels, of different thicknesses and different coatings. Some combinations, including very thin sheet, and cause weldability problems during the RSW process with mainly an insufficient penetration of the negate inside the thin sheet. So as we can see there, and we find mainly there this kind of assembly. And thanks to the software Forge, we achieved the modeling and the numerical simulation of RSW process of a three-sheet assembly, including a very thin sheet. So the assembly is composed by three sheets of different steel with different thicknesses and different coatings, as you can see there. A reference case has been defined based on experimental welding test in order to check and validate the numerical simulation. The process parameters are 8.5 kA for the intensity, 4 kN for the load applied, 350 milliseconds for the welding time, and 500 milliseconds for the forging time. The electrodes are in CRZ analog, and the curvature radius of the chips is 32 millimeters. And the aim of this work is to help to understand the origin of the weldability problem and identify the main factors influencing the negate formation, and finally try to give some solutions to improve the weldability. So the RSW process and the model are split in four different steps. First, the clamping, in which the load is applied. Second, the welding, the load is maintained and the current applied. Third, the forging, so the current is shut down in this and the load is still maintained. And finally, the cooling with the separation of the electrode. In the first approach, the model has been reduced to the consideration of the coupled electrical, thermal, and mechanical phenomena. We do not take into account the metallurgical phenomena and associated couplings, and we also do not take into account the convection phenomena occurring in the metal pond. Concerning the electrothermal contact model, two contact resistances are used, the ECR for electrical contact resistance and TCR for thermal contact resistance. The partition coefficient of the heat flux generated by Joule effect because of the electrical contact resistance is in the model equal to 0.5. And the ECR and TCR are dependent on the temperature and the maximal normal stress, what I call Pmax, due to the plastic deformations of the asperities along the contact surfaces. Mechanical contacts are solved in Ford through the penalty method and simplified contact conditions. And in this model, every contact is considered sliding, except in the cooling stage. For the sheet contact, that is bilateral sticking, it's needed to change in this step because if we do not do that, they will follow the electrode when there is the separation because we do not have in the same as in the RT. So in the RT, we have a common area for the three sheets, but it's not the case in the simulation. So the assembly studied is composed, as I said, by three sheets of dissimilar matters and thicknesses. And there is a big difference between their physical and properties and mechanical behavior. So for example, the electrical conductivity. The electrical conductivity of the AM is 2 times higher than the electrical conductivity of the 22 MnB5, for example. And for the mechanical behavior, the difference is bigger enough with a ratio of 8-9 between the AM and the 22 MnB5. So the AM is the thin sheet, and the 22 MnB5 is the is the last sheet. For the steel, the thermoelastoviscoplastic behavior is considered, and for the CuCrZr, it's a thermoelasticoplastic behavior. The electrical, thermal, and elastic properties are thermal dependent in the model. The coating for the AM and the DP is in zinc, and its thickness is around 10 micrometers. And for the 22 MnB5, there is a 30 micron, very resistive layer of aluminum silicium. As we can observe of the graph, the thermal contact resistances is around 10 times higher for the contact with the aluminum silicium. And it's still more important, it's a huge difference of 30 times between the aluminum silicium coating and the zinc coating for the electrical contact resistances. So all of the difference induce a strong dissymmetric assembly. First, I'm going to compare to check the numerical result with the experimental result. And then I will present the results of the parametric study in order to observe the influence of the different parameters on the development of the negate and its penetration inside the seed sheet. I won't take time to show the effect of the current because it's well known that with a higher current we have a bigger negate. So we'll only focus on the two other parameters that are the load and the curvature radius of the electrode. So due mainly to the strong dissymmetry between the contact resistances, the model shows that the melted pool appears quickly inside the 22 MnB5, what we also can call the PHS sheet, then grows in the assembly toward the thin sheet, that is this one. And by comparison with the micrography, we can observe that the molten pool is too big and overheated. And the main reason may be that, as I said before, we don't take into account the convective phenomena in the molten pool, maybe the mechanical behavior we input in the model, or the fact that for the experimental value, we obtain the result by measure, so on the micrography, so at ambient temperature, at 20 degrees Celsius. But in the numerical model, so the result obtained during the welding stage, so when the dilatation is very important because we are at high temperature, so more than 1,535 degrees. So here, the numerical and experimental evolution of the thickness and the radii of the nuggets are compared. And as before, we can see that the numerical values seems overestimated. So there is an important difference. But when we calculate interruptive point, so when we stop the welding at, for example, 150 milliseconds, then we take into account the forging and the cooling step, we can see that the difference is really less important, so the prediction is better. So it's the blue point here. Because the indentation of the electrode during the forging step and the thermal shrinking during the forging and the cooling step are taken into account in the numerical interruptive points. And we can see it on the evolution of the thickness of the assembly calculated by the software. So we can see that the thickness at the end of the welding or at the end of the cooling is very different. And this complex evolution is due to the thermal dilatation and shrinking and the indentation of the electrodes, so during the process. So during the first part of the welding, the dilatation is the main factor influencing the evolution of the thickness of the assembly. It meets a maximum at 180 milliseconds. And then the thermal shrinking and or the indentation are the becomes predominant in the evolution. So now I'm going to show the result of the parametrical study with first the influence of the load applied by the electrode. And then obviously a lower value of the load improves the relative penetration of the negate inside the thin sheet. Because in fact with a lower load, the contact resistances are higher, so the heat generated by Joule effects is also higher. And this faster and more important heat results in a decrease of the mechanical properties of the thin sheet, and finally in a higher indentation of the electrode in this one. So the radii of the molten pool at the interface here, between the sheet number one and sheet number two, increase continuously, and the higher values are obtained for the lower load, for exactly the same reason as I explained just before. The second parameter is the curvature radius of the electrode tips, so 32 and 50 millimeters. And the value of the intensity applied for this test corresponds to the maximal values of the range of weldability. So we took an intensity of 9.5 kA for the 32 millimeters curvature radius and 10.5 kA for the 50 millimeter for the curvature radius. And non-obviously again, when the curvature radius of the electrode is higher, the redshift penetration of the nugget inside the thin sheet is also better. Because a high curvature radius results in a lower heat during the first 100, 150 milliseconds, because the current density is lower during this period. But the intention of the electrode is less important after this 150 milliseconds. So the evolution of the contact radius is lower, and the current density is higher. So finally, the penetration of the molten pool inside the thin sheet is more important. So as we consider, there is an important difference, more important than the indentation in the thin sheet. So now the radii again. So the radii of the molten pool at the interface between the sheet 1 and sheet 2 increase also continuously. And higher values are obtained after 150 milliseconds for the higher curvature radius. So for exactly the same reason as I explained before, and we can see that it occurs at the same time. So now the last part of the presentation is about the expulsion of melted material at the sheet-sheet interface and electrode-sheet interface. So during the welding stage of the model I presented before, we observed that an extrusion is observable at the interface between the 22 MnB5 and the DP, so here. And the reasons are that the melting pool grows quickly, and the melted pool can be observed near or even reaching the knots at the interface between the two sheets. So we can see in red is the melted material. And when it's reached, so the notch, we can observe a tongue-like extruded material. So now the other problem for the expulsion at the interface between the 22 MnB5 and the electrode. So one of the possible reasons why the melted material is expulsed at this interface is the presence of a thermal discontinuity due to the fast wear of the electrode. So the fast wear of the electrode at the interface is mainly due to the aluminium silicium coating of the steel sheet. So after 80 spots, we took some pictures and we give a look to the electrode, and we can observe almost flat dome at the top of the one electrode. So this flat dome is around, has a diameter of around 4 millimeters. So we designed this one electrode and use it in our model. So the boundary conditions are exactly the same as the model I presented before. So we have a load of 4 kilonewtons, an intensity of 8 kA. So the only difference is the electrode here. And we can observe that the hot area appears near the interface and grows as in the previous models I showed before. But when it reached the discontinuity, so here, due to the flat surface of the one electrode, we can observe an extrusion of melted material. So it's not really a melted material in the model because we do not take into account the. It's only for the solid material, but we can observe that there is an extrusion at around 50 milliseconds, so it's at the real beginning of the welding process. So to conclude, this work led us to show that a strong heat is observable at the interface between the electrode and the 22 MnB5, mainly because of the aluminium silicium coating. And the process can, parameters can improve the penetration of the nugget into the thin sheet in increasing the intensity, so as it's well known, but also in decreasing the load or in increasing the curvature radius of the electrode chips. And finally, the overheating at the sheet-sheet and electrode-sheet contact combined with geometrical defects, so such as the worn electrode shape, could explain the, so we call this splashing phenomena, so extrusion of liquid material phenomena. So now for the model, the necessary improvements are finding an equivalent thermal conductivity for the, to take into account the, yes, the phenomena occurring in the molten pool, and still working on the behavior law of the steel and the CuCr-Z alloy, especially at high temperature, and especially more when it's liquid. We are also modeling a case in three dimensions, so to study the effect of a problem of coaxiality. So as we can see there, and here is the really first result we obtain. And finally, so for my PhD with PS Automobile, I'm developing a model of hybrid steel aluminium brazed welding. So it's the RSW process, but used with a sheet of aluminium and steel. So this is also one of the first results we obtained. So thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, I will try my best to answer.